Okay, so today we're going to do, I guess it's a little bit more econometrics oriented. So the first lecture, I'm going to talk more about some of these methods and just how they work, how you implement them, what are they useful for. And then in the second half, we'll look at more of the applications, you know, so you can see what types of questions people have been answering using these types of models. Okay, and a lot of this is based on, like, if you want to read something that kind of goes along with these lectures, I took a lot of the examples from this Handbook of Labor Economics chapter that I wrote with Mike Keen and Ken Wolpen. Okay, and so over the last 25 years, there has been a lot of work in the development of, they're called discrete choice dynamic programming models, because usually you're modeling discrete choices, you know, that's the distinguishing characteristic. They're used in a lot of different fields. Labor economics predominantly, but lately a lot of people have been working on these types of models for industrial organization. There are a few applications like in demography, modeling fertility, or in health or development, and in political economy. Okay, most of my examples focus on labor and development. All right, and so they started in the early 1980s.
Can you speak up a bit? In the back here, you don't hear so well.
Oh, the microphone? You know, with the microphone, it's okay. Okay, I can try to talk louder. Okay, so these are some of the earliest applications of these types of models in the mid 80s. And mainly for computational reasons, the early can you hear? No? Okay. At home, everybody complains I yell all the time. So in the earliest models, you basically had a binary decision. Just do you do one thing or do you do something else? And the main reason for that was mainly computational. So for example, one paper considered the decision whether to re-enlist in the military or not. So they had a sample of a lot of people in the military and they were just looking at like when they retired or whether they kept going. Bob Miller had the decision about whether to stay in the same job or to change jobs. Ariel Pecas had the decision about whether, when a patent expires, whether a firm renews its patent. John Rust had a decision about when do you optimally replace a bus engine. So these are all like decisions you would make in a dynamic setting, but they're all binary decisions. Ken Wolpen had a decision about when do you have a child, and he was looking at the case where there's a high infant mortality and whether the families replace children, I mean not really replaced, but whether they have additional children, you know, if they experience infant mortality in their family. Okay, and so I just want to give you some insights into how you specify and estimate these types of models and show you that they're actually pretty close to the static framework that you're probably already familiar with, and look at like different ways that you can use these models for the purpose of policy evaluation. Okay, and we're going to consider first, a binary choice model where an economic agent is making a decision between two alternatives, and we'll start with the static case and then go to the dynamic case. Okay, and in the static case, usually we specify these decision problems as what are called threshold crossing models, right, where you just have a decision or a utility associated with decision one or decision zero, right? And so you have dit equals one if you take decision one in period t, and you just take the decision with the biggest payoff. Can you hear me okay now? Yeah. Okay. All right, and in these models, you could think of there being three different types of variables. So D is an indicator for choices, capital D is a vector, anything with a little tilde is a vector of all the past choices. Then we may have some additional variables that are just some exogenous variables, like for example, maybe state of the economy. And then you also usually in these problems have some unobservables, right? So we need unobservables to explain why two people with the same observables we might observe making different decisions, right? So we have to recognize that there are things they may know that we don't know. Okay, and the decision problem then is just like a threshold whether, so this V star represents the utility from option one versus option zero. And so when the utility from option one is greater, then you choose D equals one. Okay, and both the static models and the dynamic models can be put in this type of formulation. So that's what I'm going to show you, how the dynamic model is basically an extension of the static modeling framework. And it's forward-looking if V contains either past choices, because if past choices enter, then when you make a decision today, that has implications for the future. And that's what makes it dynamic. Or it could be that some of the epsilons are serially correlated, and in that case, shocks today affect your forecast of what shocks are going to be in the future, right? So otherwise, it would be like a repeated static problem, you know. But if you have like lagged options affect future choices, then that makes it a dynamic problem. Okay, so there are many different things that empirical researchers might want to do with this type of model. So first is maybe you just want to test the prediction of some theory, or you might want to determine the impact of like a change in D on choices. Like for example, you know, D may represent whether you go to school or not, and you want to determine the impact of if you could get someone to go to school additional year, how would that affect like their probability of going to college in the future, something like that. Or maybe you might want to determine the impact of something that's not in D or X. And I'll show you some examples of like a subsidy to childcare, right? So you may have a program, I think in Germany even, they give childcare subsidies. And you may want to see like how does that stimulate female labor force behavior, for example. So that would be an example of something that's not in D or X, but it just affects the decision problem through the budget constraint. You know, and we'd like to see, and maybe forecast, like use these models to forecast for different subsidy levels, what would be the implied labor force participation rate. You know, so ideally these models could even be used to forecast the effects of policies that we've never had before. So that's something I've been working on lately a lot is like, because that helps you optimally design policies. You know, so not only do we want to know what an existing policy, what effect that had, but we'd like to know like what if we doubled the subsidy level? You know, how much bigger effect would we have if we changed the environment some way? Okay, so here's an example of this type of model. So here, and it's a unitary model, so it's just assumed like a husband and wife are making this decision jointly. The utility depends on consumption and on female labor supply. So D equals one if the wife works, otherwise it equals zero. Then kappa are just some observables affecting utility from leisure. So for example, how many young kids she has at home, that might affect her utility from staying home. I mean, it's not really leisure, it's staying home. And then epsilon, you'll see that you need a shock. You need, usually in these models, as many shocks as you have choices. And that's to get a non-degenerate likelihood. So we'll see like how you specify the likelihood. But epsilon are like preference shocks from leisure. Okay, and so right now you can just think of it as a static model, and then later we'll look at how we extend it to the dynamic case. Okay, and then the utility function we would normally choose to have usual properties, like increasing marginal utility, or diminishing marginal utility, or positive utility from consumption. So there are many different choices how you could specify utility, but there's a variety of options. And then the wife is going to get a wage offer. So if the wife is working, we see her wage. But if she's not working, we don't see the wage. And so therefore, you need to specify a wage offer function, because you have to describe what wage are we going to have for people that are not working, right? So we'll assume that the wife gets a wage W, and then the husband, if he works, he gets an income Y. Okay, so a lot of the early models didn't have male labor supply because it was just assumed that all men worked. I mean, nowadays it's actually not true because male labor supply has been going down and female labor supply has been increasing. But this is still kind of an old-fashioned model. So men are just supplying income, and then women are making this working decision. And this pie is the child care subsidy. So if a woman chooses to work, which means D equals 1, let's see. So here, if D equals 1, then per child, she incurs a cost pi. So that's like the cost of putting the child in daycare. And then ultimately, we'll look at like how you could use these models to vary pi and see like what are the implications for labor supply. Okay, and the wage offer function, so if we knew wages for everybody, then we wouldn't need this, right? But usually for people that aren't working, you don't know their wage, so you need to specify some sort of equation. And we'll assume the wage depends on some observables, z. Okay, and for now, to keep the model static, we wouldn't put in labor supply. Labor experience. Because normally in a wage equation, you put in experience, but experience is a function of past labor supply decisions. You know, so for now, just think of it as maybe put in like potential experience. And then later we'll look at how do you put in like actual experience. And then Z could be things, say, like educational attainment. And then we'll just assume that these shocks are just randomly drawn and independently over time. So there are two shocks that are unobservable. One is a preference shock, and then the other one is the wage shock. And we'll assume that they have some joint distribution, those two shocks. Okay, it could be normal. You know, for right now, I'm not assuming normality, but later on, we'll look at the normal case. So if you substitute in for consumption, this is your utility function. So I'm just putting in for C from the budget constraint, just substituting that in. And then U1 is the utility if the wife works. So if she works, then she gets wages, but she has to pay the childcare costs and she doesn't get leisure. If she doesn't work, then she only, you know, the couple only has the husband's income, but then the wife has the leisure, you know, and then she gets this preference shock to her utility from staying home. Okay, and those are the two utilities that would be compared. And then the latent variable function is just, you know, U1 minus U0. So when that's greater than 0, then she chooses to work, right? So that would be like the simple static framework. These are the types of models, for example, in amemia. You know, if you look and you estimate this with like a probit or logit, something like that, right? So probably you've seen these types of models, right? Okay, so the state space are all the state space consists of observable components and unobservable components. So the full state space are all the determinants of the household's decision. So those are all the observed things, right? And like Z, those were the things that entered the wage offer equation, plus the unobservables, right? That's the full state space. The part that we see consists of the observable components. So this notation with the little minus sign just means the observed part of the state space. So we're subtracting off the unobserved part. Okay, and then we can define a set S to be the set of unobservables that would induce someone to work. Okay, so given that those draws, they would choose to work. Okay, and then we can write down the probability under this model that we see the wife working. You know, so ultimately the goal is going to be, you know, different, well, we'll have different goals, you know, and we'll look at different types of models that could answer different types of questions. Okay, so feel free if there are any questions to interrupt. Okay, but this is just integrating over all the unobservables that would lead you to choose one. All right, so and this G function here consists of different elements, right? So in the model, we had the utility function, the wage offer equation, and the joint distribution of the shocks, right? So the structure of the model are the things that are like invariant to policies, right? Those are the things that, like, when we change the subsidy, we would expect to hold constant. Right, so the utility function is like what's called a structural element of the model. So if we were trying to do what's called structural estimation, then we would be trying to uncover some of these structural elements, right? The wage offer equation, the utility function, the joint distribution. Those are things that are supposed to be stable even if you change the policies, right? Like if we change the wage subsidy, let's say we double the subsidy, that affects the budget constraint, right? But it's not going to change the utility function, right? So structural estimation would try to uncover these things. Non-structural estimation would just have as its goal to just recover the G function. So here, if you look at this probability that you work, you know, so if you just estimate a probit model, do you work or not, that would be a non-structural approach, and we're just trying to uncover this G function, right? And you see that actually combines all these different things, because these all enter into the G function, okay? So for some questions, that may be sufficient, just to, you know, do it that way. And for other questions, we may need to actually uncover the U, the W, and the F, right? So it depends on what question you're asking, what type of approach you need to take. Okay, and so you can actually distinguish different types of approaches. So you could think of like a non-parametric, non-structural approach. So non-parametric means that we don't impose a specific functional form on the G function, that we allow that to be flexible. Okay, I mean, technically a model is parametric if it has a finite number of parameters. Okay, and then there's some models that are kind of in between that are called semi-parametric, but the non-parametric is just allowing the G function to be flexible. Then we have, you can also do a parametric approach, like if I did a probit model, that would be a parametric approach. Or we could think, so this is not very common, non-parametric structural, because this is pretty difficult to do actually. There are a few things you can do non-parametric structural, but at parametric structural, most of the examples I'll show you adopt a fully parametric model and then try to recover the underlying structural elements. Okay. So like these are some goals we may have, and we can think about how would we answer these types of questions with the different approaches. Okay, so suppose we wanted to test the model, you know, so to test the model, you could test some implications of the model. So the model, one of the implications is that the probability of working should be increasing in the wage offer. Okay, so we could test that. We could test the effect of just changing some state variables in the model. Or this goal three, this is the childcare subsidy. So let's say we want to vary the subsidy pi. So this would be like a policy, yeah, right? That the government has a childcare subsidy and we want to vary that and see how it affects labor supply. You know, and it could be that in the data, we don't actually have variation, so that you can't just draw on variation in the data. So maybe in the data there's one subsidy level and we'd like to see, well, what if we changed it? Okay, so this is kind of a more difficult question because there's no variation in the data. Okay, so non-parametric, non-structural. So if we just wanted to test, is the probability of working increasing in the wage offer? Well, we don't see the wage offer for everybody, but we do see some variables Z here that are assumed to enter into the wage offer. Okay, so if you look here, in order to test whether the wage offer increase a higher wage increases the probability of working, you have to be able to independently vary Z and kappa. So remember, I know it's hard with the notation sometimes, but kappa were the factors that affected the utility of staying home, and Z are the factors that enter the wage offer equation. Okay? So in order to test whether the probability of working is increasing in the wage offer, you need to be able to vary Z holding kappa constant, right? Because it would be a problem if kappa and Z fully overlapped. You actually have to have some variables in Z that are not in kappa. Okay, so those types of variables are called exclusion restrictions. They're kind of related to the idea of instrumental variables. So something that independently varies Z holding kappa constant. And you'll see that they play an important role in a lot of these models. Okay, but so you need that to be able to, say, do this goal one. Okay. Now goal two, given an estimate of G, you can change any of those components of G. So you could change the X, you know, and see how that affects. If we do G non-parametrically, the limitation of non-parametric analysis is you cannot extrapolate outside the range of the variables observed in your data. So like if you think of if you've ever had to do non-parametric regression, like a kernel regression, you can only do those in the region where you actually have data, right? Non-parametric methods don't let you extrapolate to other regions. So you may think it's a limitation, but it's also sometimes a good thing because parametric methods let you extrapolate and you may not always be aware of how good the extrapolation is. So, but that's a trade-off. Most people would just do a Logit or Probit, but like, does anybody know, say, a non-parametric estimator you could use instead of Logit or Probit? Like a maximum score estimator, or there's like semi-parametric least squares, or there's like Klein and Spady, like a maximum likelihood. So there are a bunch of non-parametric binary choice model estimators that you could use. They're not used that often, but okay. And then it's not possible here to separately identify G from pi. So this, the third policy goal, like where we vary the childcare subsidy, we could not do in a non-parametric, non-structural framework. Okay, so we can't vary pi. And that's because pi, because I'm assuming that you don't see pi and there's no variation in pi in the data. So therefore, pi n always enters together, and so you couldn't separate out the pi here. Okay, so knowledge, this can't, you can't separate out the g pi n from this pi. So we can't perform the child care subsidy experiment. Okay. All right, now parametric non-structural, the only difference would be we assume, you know, a fully parametric distribution like a Probit or a Logit, right? Those are the most common ones. And the only benefit there is that you can extrapolate outside the range of the data. So we could vary some of these factors. So if you look at the G function here, so let's say we wanted to vary husband's income, something like that. So you could actually extrapolate outside the range of incomes observed in your data. Right, with a parametric model, but with a non-parametric model, you couldn't do that. Or you wanted to vary kappa, see how that affects mother's labor supply. Okay. Now, so nonparametric structural, it's actually, yeah, usually it's infeasible. I have one paper where we try to do some, like Ken and I actually tried to do some nonparametric structural, but okay, but in this model, we couldn't do this policy analysis without recovering the structural part. Sometimes you can be like parametric about one aspect of the model and less parametric about a different aspect, but being fully nonparametric structural is not feasible here. But here, consider what we could do with a parametric structural model. Okay, and in this case, you'll see you can actually do this childcare policy experiment. So here we actually write down a utility function. And this is just a very simple one. So it's additive in consumption and utility from leisure. And then we assume the preference, this alpha is a preference for leisure, and we allow that to depend on these factors kappa plus a preference shock. Now this second equation is the budget constraint. Third equation is the wage offer. And then we're going to assume a joint normal distribution on the shocks. So then this eta and epsilon are joint normally distributed, some variance-covariance matrix. So it's fully parametric because all the parameters are finite, right? Everything's specified, and it's finite number of parameters. Okay, now the difference in utilities, one interesting thing is husband's income drops out because husband's income they get no matter what, right? So because it's additive here, husband's income in the end doesn't make any difference. Like if we had an interaction between C and 1 minus D, you know, then it would still, husband's income would appear. But because it's so simple, it just drops out. So Y actually disappears. But this is the difference in utility between working and not working. And so this is that threshold crossing model. So we don't need additivity normally, it's just done here for simplicity. Okay, and we actually, the other thing that's a little weird about this example is wages are linear, and normally we would assume log wages are linear. Like if you do labor economics, it probably looks strange to have wages linear. Okay, so you can actually extend this to log wages linear. It's just that the equations are a little simpler, keeping everything linear. Okay, and how would we estimate this type of model? Well, you'd write down the probability in terms of the likelihood of if a person works, you see two things. You see that they're working and you see their wage. If they're not working, all you know is they're not working, right? You don't see their wage. So this is the likelihood, right? And so we can break this down. So this is this shock, the wage is that the probability that the shock takes this value, right? And so we have to basically, given the distributional assumptions, write in this probability. And that's how we'd estimate the model. And these are all the parameters that we'd try to recover. And those would give us all the structural elements, right? Because if we have these parameters, then we'd have the utility function, we'd have the wage offer equation parameters. So this childcare cost now, okay, so if remember the pi multiplies by n. So if n is also an element of kappa, so if her utility from staying home depends on how many children she has, then in this model, when we do the estimation, we wouldn't be able to separate out the beta from the pi. Like if kappa also contains n. So from doing the estimation, you would get beta plus pi. This beta n is just allowing for kappa to have other things in it. You know, but you jointly identify the utility parameter plus this childcare subsidy. You couldn't separate out the two. Okay. Now given the wage offer equation, you could do like a simple Heckman two-step type estimator. And so from that, you could actually identify the wage equation. Let's see here. If you look, you would get this gamma, and then you'd also get, these are all the things you'd get just from the wage equation using a Heckman two-step estimator. Okay. And then from the probe, if I just did a probit model, since it's normal, we could do a probit model, do you work or not? And from the probit model, you would get gamma divided by the psi, I guess I should have mentioned. This is the definition of this psi here, is the difference in the two errors. Okay. So you would get separately this gamma over sigma psi and beta over sigma psi. And then for anything that overlaps, like where z and kappa have the same variables, you would get gamma minus beta over sigma psi, right, if they're overlapping. Okay, so you can see that because from the wage equation, I get gamma by itself. And then from the probit model, I get these things up to a factor 1 over sigma psi. That implies I can actually also get the sigma psi, right? Is that clear? Like from the... So if I can get this gamma by itself from the wage equation, and then I can get this divided by sigma psi, that means I now have an estimate of sigma psi. Okay, so that's going to be important actually for doing this child care subsidy. We're going to need the estimate of the sigma psi. Okay, so, and I would not get that estimate if I didn't have an exclusion restriction. So even in this model where everything is parametric and I fully specify everything, I also need an exclusion restriction. Because if kappa and z, so remember, z are the parameters in the wage equation, and kappa are the parameters in the utility function. If they would all overlap, then I wouldn't be able to separate out, because then I'd get gamma minus beta over sigma psi, and I couldn't separate these things out. Okay, so I need at least one variable in z that's not in kappa, because that one variable in z will give me gamma over sigma psi by itself, and that'll let me back out the sigma psi. Okay. So even in this model, I still need exclusion restriction in order to get a separate estimate of that sigma. Okay, so now why is it useful that I have this estimate of sigma? So in this model, so this is what I just said, that you need an exclusion restriction. So in this model, we can also determine the effect of changing any of the variables within and outside the range of the data, because it's a parametric model. So now let's look at the most interesting policy, I think, is policy 3. So remember, we can get beta plus pi if n is one of the elements of the kappa. Now consider a change in the subsidy level. Okay, and we're going to subsidize childcare by tau. Okay, so the way that operates within the model is it changes the couple's budget constraint, right? So now if the woman works, she gets the wage, but then she has to pay pi, but now we subtract off tau. So like if the daycare was $500 and now we give a $200 subsidy, And you could also target the subsidy at certain people if you wanted to do that. You know, we could do it targeted if we wanted. That would be like tau being individual specific, you know. But here we're just doing where everybody gets the subsidy. So it changes the budget constraint. And then you can write down what's the probability of working given the subsidy. Okay? And so from the estimation, we got beta plus pi, right? Those were the parameters we estimated. And now you see, if I also have 1 over sigma, then I actually can predict the probability of working with the subsidy, right? And I can vary tau, like I can consider subsidies at different levels, like $100 or euro, $200, $300, and I could trace out how does that affect the working behavior. And to do this policy analysis, I did not even have to know what pi was, right? Like I don't see pi and there's no variation in pi in the data. And you can still actually analyze the effect of a subsidy, okay? So it sounds kind of, you know, miraculous, like how can you analyze these questions without even knowing what the current subsidy level is, right? But the reason you can do that is that operationally, you know, the subsidy in some ways is analogous to a change in the wage. Because if the woman now gets the subsidy every time she works, essentially she's getting like a higher wage from working. You know, and we see women with all different wages in the data, and so that gives us some policy relevant variation. You know, so it's kind of, you have very, and the model is telling us, you know, how wages actually enter into the problem. So the subsidy is analogous to like an increase in wage for these women, right? But of course, within this budget constraint, the subsidy is bigger for people that have more children because it's a per child subsidy. You know, so you need the structure of the model to figure out like how does the subsidy influence the probability of working. Okay, but this is the usefulness of actually recovering the different structural elements and, you know, imposing some assumptions, for example, the normality assumptions and functional form assumptions, that you can do this type of policy analysis. And this is what we call ex-ante policy analysis. You know, ex-post would be if you have an existing policy and you just figure out what's the treatment effect of that policy. Right? But ideally, you might want to actually analyze policies before you implement them. You know, because it's very expensive to put in a bunch of policies and then later on say, oh, it didn't work. You know, like it would be nice to know a little bit ahead of time what policy might work, you know, what level subsidy should you implement. Like I saw a paper that was very close to this type of example in the former Soviet Union, I guess. Daycare used to be free, and so everybody could just put their kids in daycare. And then when they, you know, had the transition to market economy, then suddenly the price of daycare became very high, you know, and people had to pay for it. And so then they implemented some policies that were subsidizing daycare, especially for like low-income families. You know, so it was very analogous to this type of policy. And you'd want to see like what's the optimal level of pi. You know, and so here you can trace it out. And the other thing that you can do here is you can predict how much this program would cost the government, right? Because you just figure out the probability that each woman works, and then given the number of women, you can actually forecast the cost of providing different subsidies, because you can predict who takes up the program. Okay. So the critical aspect here is that we have to have some variation in the wage in order to do this, and the exclusion restriction is very important, right? Otherwise, we couldn't have identified the sigma psi. Okay. So wage variation is basically providing us this policy-relevant variation to get these parameters. So for some questions, I think it depends on what type of question you have. So for some question, you know, non-structural estimation would be sufficient. And you might even say in some cases it's preferable, you know, because you're not imposing all these assumptions.
Maybe you can have stay here. Can you say a little bit about how sensitive this is to misspecifying the utility function or...
Because there's always the risk that, you know, you didn't pick the right utility function. And so the only way really to guard against that, I mean, there are these tests, you can do a lot of tests of models, you know, like if you estimate the model by maximum likelihood, I mean, what people would commonly do is they would do like a lot of with what are called within sample fit tests, where you look at proportions in the data and you look at proportions implied by the model, you know, and so there's some formal test statistics that you, I mean, a lot of times actually these models don't pass the test. It's kind of like in macro, they do a lot of GMM and they do like J tests, you know, of the moments. And a lot of times they don't pass the test. But those types of statistics are available just to test models, you know, to see if they're roughly consistent with the data. Or you could check sensitivity. This model's simple enough that you could do different utility functions and see how sensitive it is. But I don't think there's a good way of doing it without actually implementing the model.
In terms of predicting probabilities, and for example, and you would also split the sample and look at subsamples, how well it predicts probabilities in subsamples?
You could do some, there are different ways. So, I mean, one is you could just re-estimate the model all under alternative specifications if it's simple enough. Or you could, sometimes people do leave out some of the data, estimate the model with part of the data set, and then forecast the behavior of, right? Because you could estimate the model, let's say you used half your data, you estimate your model parameters, then you use your model to try and forecast behavior for the other half. And then see how well it forecasts. But even that is a trade-off because using half the data, your parameters are not going to be as good. You know, so when you do, so when you do like a, that's called like an out-of-sample validation. So they're within sample fit tests where you just compare the predicted probability, like what you could do is for different women. So women with different state spaces here, you have a proportion, a predicted proportion working under the model, and you could compare that to the actual proportion. I think Don Andrews actually has a test where you can just compare these predicted proportions for a whole bunch of different state space elements. You know, and then you can do a formal test. That would be like a within sample test of the fit. Or you could do this out-of-sample validation. But to do that, you have to actually not use some of the data in estimation. And then maybe your parameters are not as good because you're not using all the variation in the data that you could be using. Okay. But that is the big question with these types of models is, you know, misspecification could lead you to have bad predictions of the policy. I mean, I've been doing some work lately with situations where you have a randomized policy where we actually try to forecast the effect of some program, like using a control group, say, and then we compare it to the treatment effect that you got from a randomized experiment. Right? But it's you need a special sort of data because you need to have like randomized data set, and you need to have a policy that you could actually forecast with some model. So, I mean, we've been doing these conditional cash transfer programs that pay families to send their children to school and forecasting the effect of those programs and seeing how well our forecasts line up with the treatment effects that you get from the RCT. Okay, so that's another way that it's out of sample but using randomized data. So that's another way that you could test how well these models work. So I think we actually need more evidence because, you know, there's so many different applications. And for a lot of the different studies, you only have one or two models. So we don't have a really good sense about what type of model is best. Or that's what Philip is working on partly, you know, looking at a whole bunch of different types of models to see which models are best, like in what context. Okay, so that was just a simple static model, and I just wanted to show you the connection to dynamic models that, you know, they're not actually that much more complicated to specify. So we're going to introduce dynamics just by putting in actual labor market experience. So instead of potential experience, we're going to put in the actual experience, which is the sum of past working decisions. So now this becomes a dynamic model, because when you consider, do I work today, you take into account that if I work today, I'll have more experience tomorrow, and that'll increase my future wage. Okay, and so we also need an additional equation just to describe how work experience evolves with working decisions. We'll keep the assumption that there's a joint distribution of shocks and that they're IID, but this assumption can also be relaxed. And so later I'll talk about like how you can relax these assumptions to bring in more dependence over time. Okay, and so now we'll assume that the couple maximizes expected present discounted value of remaining lifetime utility. Okay, so this is going to be the decision problem at some time t. So they're looking at the expected, so the expectation, the only thing that's unobserved are all the future shocks. So the expectation is taking the expectation over all future shocks given the state space that we have today. Okay. Let's see. Okay, so the only thing this state space now includes labor market experience. And we can write this as a value function, or it's a maximization over two different options. So either you work or you don't work. And this is the value if you work today. So we can write it in what's called Bellman equation form. And I mean, most of the models I work on are finite horizon models. So I wrote this as a finite horizon model. So in the last period, there's no future. So there's some period where there's no future. So that's cap T. So that would be like maybe the retirement age, right? That the women retire at some age and then they don't make a working decision. And then in periods before, you have this future. This part of the model is called an Emax. Okay. So the expectation is taken over the distribution of all the random components, conditional on the state space elements. And she's just deciding one choice here, like d equals 0 or d equals 1 at every time period. Okay, and the next period state space is basically the last period augmented to include now this additional information on what her choice was. Okay, so if we write the threshold crossing model, it's the same as in the static case. This part is all the same, but now you have this additional piece, and that's the difference between the future expected value. Right? Because this is now, because she takes into account if she works today, it affects her future value function. Okay, but otherwise everything's the same. And in the last period, because it's finite horizon, the last period is the same as the static model. Okay. And actually we can set up the probability, solve by maximum likelihood. Everything is the same. The only thing is that we have to have a way of coming up with these things. Okay. All right. So we have to be able to calculate these alternative specific value functions. And you see that you need this at all elements of the state space, omega. Right? So I haven't told you yet, you know, how I'm going to get these things, but otherwise everything about the problem is the same. So the dynamics doesn't really introduce additional complication, except that we have to come up with a way of getting these things. Okay. So to solve the dynamic programming problem, we actually have to find these expected value functions. Okay, and a lot of times these are called Emax functions. Okay, so the way we normally solve these models is by backwards recursion, starting in the last period. And the reason is the last period doesn't involve the future, right? The last period just has this. So that's kind of the easiest period to start with. So I'll show you like how how you actually solve these through backwards recursion. So in this problem, the woman's just deciding whether to work or not, you know, and there's no, right now I'm not modeling like fertility evolving, because it could be her number of kids is changing over time. So for now, just assume she's like old enough that her number of kids is non-stochastic. And then later we're going to consider how you might introduce like N changing over time as well into this type of model. Okay, so to calculate, we need to calculate this Emax T. And to do this, you can actually use some results about normal random variables, so truncated normal random variables. So this is conditioning, so let's see. We have to actually calculate here. Well, the expected utility given that you work and given that you don't work. So given that you work here, this is the notation. So you work if psi is greater than or equal to this negative psi star. This is this threshold. Okay, and so we need now like the expected value of the error term given that you work and given that you don't work. Okay, and so this is just some algebra, but these are formulas for truncated normal random variables. They're like Mills ratio type formulas. Okay. And so just, this is through some algebra. You can figure out the Emax in the last time period. Right, and we're using this, that the Emax of U and V is E of U given U greater than V times probability U greater than V and E of V given V greater than U. So you need this formula here. Okay, but you can actually figure out, in this model, since it's simple, I mean, usually it's not simple enough to do analytically. This model, because it's just one discrete choice and just a couple of errors and everything's additive, so you can actually just do it analytically. Normally, I wouldn't do analytically because I normally have way more than two choices. You know, like some models have like 800 choices or something, so, so this is just a simpler model. Okay, you have to normally integrate over the errors when you do this, and even in the normal case, there's no closed form for the integral, and so those things are normally done using numerical methods. Okay, but well, doing this, we can come up with a value of the Emax for each possible state space element. Okay. And for each time period, because that's what we need. So if you look here, we need to have this for every possible omega and for every time period. Okay? And then once we have that, then we can just do maximum likelihood the way we did before. So that's the only new requirement, is that we have to come up with these things. Okay. Right, so here's the value function if I look in period t minus 1, so that's the right before the last period. So this is the utility if she doesn't work, and then she gets the future Emax where her experience stays the same. Because if she doesn't work, then h is the same ht minus 1, right? Now if she does work, she gets ht minus 1 plus 1. Okay, so the state space in the future is going to be different depending on her choice today about working or not working. Okay, but these are the things that we calculated from the previous slide, like in this way. So you got the Emax at all possible omegas. So that means I have this at every possible set. This is omega. This is all the stuff that constitutes omega. Okay, and then I go back, once I have this value function in period t minus 1, then I can go back to period t minus 2, and I'm going to be using this value function to calculate the Emax in period t minus 2. Okay, so this is now the threshold crossing for period t minus 1. Yeah, again, like income drops out. Actually, Okay, and then we just, so that's why you go backwards. And so the first step to solving these types of models is you first have to come up with all the Emaxes. Okay, so these models are solved in like two stages. So first you have to get the Emaxes, then you specify the likelihood. Okay, and you do that, and normally when you do maximum likelihood, you're searching over the parameter space. You know, so you have some set of parameters. Given that set of parameters, you solve all the Emaxes. Then you use those Emaxes to set up the likelihood. And then you evaluate the likelihood and you move to a new set of parameters. And then you again go back and solve the Emaxes, and then you do the likelihood again. So it kind of iterates between solving the Emaxes, and solving the Emaxes is what's called solving the dynamic programming problem. Then you use that solution to do the likelihood. But you actually have to resolve the dynamic programming problem every time you change parameters. Okay, so the hard part of these models is more computation. You know, there's a lot of computation involved in solving the Emaxes. Okay, and so far, I haven't really said anything about the data, but the data is not used in solving the dynamic program. So the data is only used in specifying the likelihood, because the dynamic program has to be solved at every possible state space, including state space elements that were maybe never chosen in the data. You know, so the data only comes in the likelihood part. Okay, we'll look at, you know, at some likelihoods, and even the time period of the model does not have to match the time period of the data. Like, you could actually have a model that goes to age 65, but your data, maybe nobody's older than age 35. Like, that's actually allowed. And you don't have to observe everybody over their whole life or something like that to estimate this model. You know, maybe you only see people for 2 or 3 years, even though you have a model that goes over their whole lifetime. Okay, so. And the reason is that there's structure on the problem that the utility function is stable over time. So you're using that structure. Okay. So we'll look at some examples of this. All right, so these slides are just going through like what's the value function in the different time periods. We solve backwards, solve the dynamic programming problem, get all the Emaxes. Once you have the Emaxes, that gives you all those cutoffs, and then you can write down the likelihood. Okay, so we need to now, to solve the dynamic version, we need to have data on work experience. So assume that we have data for married couples, denote by T1 is the first time period and TL the last time period. Okay, and this would now be the likelihood. So this is the likelihood for the dynamic model. So we have the product over individuals and the product over time periods, where we could see couples for different amounts of time periods. And it could even be one time period. Well, yeah, I think, well, you'd have to have the state space. So maybe you need at least two time periods here. And the only part where the Emaxes come in is to figure out this threshold, this psi star. Okay, but otherwise you see that the likelihood is the same, right, for the static model and the dynamic model. Okay, and we can actually relax all these things. We don't really have to have additivity. I'll show you how to extend it to more choices, not just two, you know, because a lot of times that was state of the art in the 80s because computers were really bad. But nowadays, you don't have to limit yourself to two choices, you know. So you can extend it to as many choices as you want. This model, though, is analytically very simple, so you can actually write down the analytical likelihood. But usually, it's not possible to do this in a more complicated model.
So you don't have to deal with something like an initial conditions problem or something like that, as long as you observe some people that start
Right.
Oh, you mean for H? Well, initial conditions problem. So that would occur, for example, if you see people, like in this case, you see people with some given labor market experience, right?
So what if you have a sample where you don't see the beginning of the labor market? Yeah.
Yeah, so you probably see people in the middle of their lifetime. Because of the shocks being IID, you know, that's not going to cause a problem here. It would cause a problem if the shocks were not IID, because then when you condition on, so the probability that they work today, conditional on their behavior yesterday, is going to be the same function. It's not, like if the shocks were serially correlated, then if I would condition on the fact that they worked before, then I know that they probably got a low preference shock to leisure. And then knowing that would be informative about their shock today, and that would affect the distribution of shocks today. So then initial conditions would cause a problem because I'm conditioning on information that's relevant for their error distribution today. You know, so, but it, because we assume that shocks are IID, then initial conditions is not a problem in this. So there are actually big benefits to assuming certain sorts of error structures. Because sometimes people just assume away the initial conditions problem. They'll just assume that it's not a problem, basically. But it always comes up if you're conditioning on elements in the state space that are functions of the choices that people are making. Like in a fertility model, if I were conditioning on the number of kids that they have, right, that would be like prior fertility. Or in a schooling model, if I were conditioning on like what their total education is whenever they start. Okay, but the IID shocks is getting us out of the initial conditions problem here. Yeah. Okay, so the main thing is you just iterate between solving the dynamic program and specifying the likelihood. And then you can estimate this by maximum likelihood. Alternatively, you could estimate it by simulated method of moments. There's not, you know, if the first order if your moments were the first order condition of the likelihood, then it would be the same thing, right? Then method of moments and maximum likelihood would give you the same. Normally, well, actually, partly, Philip, right? You have this paper with Heckman, right? Or, yeah. So they did a paper where they had the same model that they estimated by simulated maximum likelihood and also by simulated method of moments, and they showed that simulated maximum likelihood does much better because it's using all the information versus like method of moments is usually more ad hoc, you know, because maximum likelihood, you're using all the information that's in the data. So after reading their paper, and I was actually the editor on their paper at the IER, it's really nice paper. You know, now I always tell all my students that if you have a choice, it's better to do maximum likelihood in these types of models. The only case where it can be difficult is if you're missing elements of the state space. Like, for example, some of the elements of omega you don't see, or there might be missing data patterns. You know, like some years this is missing, you know, then it can be a little harder because you have to integrate out over the missings when you write down the likelihood. I mean, you have to go through, when you specify likelihood, let's say a missing work experience, well, they could have worked or they could have not worked. So then when I write the likelihood, I have to actually add up all the possibilities that the missing could be, you know. Which is also possible if you're missing 1 year, but when you start missing multiple years, it gets to be a little complicated. So for missing data, you might want to do method of moments, but otherwise, if you have a choice, maximum likelihood, has much better performance according to the results of their paper.
What's the intuition? What is it?
What it uses?
For
missing data?
No. Oh. What is it that?
Method of moments
in general.
Well, I think it's just method moments the way, it would be the same if you had the first order condition from the likelihood, but that's not what people do normally. They just kind of ad hoc, you know, specify moments. And it's hard to know if the moments even identify the parameters, you know, and yeah. And so therefore, maximum likelihood, you're using all the information that's in the data. So I think the efficiency gains, are, they find them to be big.
Yeah. I mean, one of the interesting aspects of that was that there's actually a link between the economic model that you're studying and the performance of the simulation. Right? Because when you simulate a sample from your structural model, you always have to draw the random disturbances, right? Present shocks here. And the economic models are usually data sets are usually characterized by large variances, unobserved variability. And this unobserved variability then translates into a noisy criterion function. And this criterion function is based on the evaluation of the moments, based on a simulated model. So that's kind of that's what makes it nice. It's because it's the economics or the application of these methods to economic models through the large unobserved variability leads to poor performance.
Yeah, so it actually had a big influence on the recommendation that I make to my students always. You know, if they're able to do maximum likelihood, I tell them that's a better route to get better estimates. Okay. Let's see. So there is one additional parameter in the dynamic model versus the static model, but it's only one, which is the discount factor. That you can identify partly just due to these nonlinearities, you know, that the Emacs function is a different function of the state space elements from the systematic component, and so that allows you to separate out the additional parameter. But there's only one additional parameter, right? Although all the parameters, when you do the estimation, I mean, it's a good idea to start with the static model, maybe as starting values, and then use those as starting values for the dynamic model. You know, because you want to start with a good guess. So you normally, if you start with a static model, that provides a pretty good guess. But there is a, even though conceptually the difference is not that great, there is a big computational effort from that comes from having to solve the dynamic programming problem. So there's a lot of work just on trying to figure out computational methods that simplify this. You know, especially if you have a large state space, then it can be very computational to have to evaluate these Emaxes at all the elements of the state space. So that's the main complication. It's more computational. Okay, and it requires the exclusion restriction, you know, just as even with the non-structural model, that's important, the exclusion restriction. And if I did a policy effect in the static model versus the dynamic model, you might see different policy implications. You know, so if I give a childcare policy in the static model, you don't get the additional benefit, because in the dynamic model, the woman would think, well, if I work, not only is it cheaper, but I also will have higher experience tomorrow, and I'll get a higher wage tomorrow. You know, so you might actually get a bigger effect of the policy in the dynamic model than you would in the static model, right? And then another interesting thing about these dynamic models is that policies can have effects when they're pre-announced, even before they take place. You know, so if you told someone there's going to be a childcare subsidy in 5 years, you know, that would already potentially affect their behavior today. So you can incorporate that into the model, because it'll affect them today because of the Emacs. You know, the Emacs is going to change knowing that in 5 years this policy is going to come in. And so it matters when people learn about policies. You know, in these models, if a policy is a surprise, you know, then it couldn't affect their Emacs until it appears. But if a policy is pre-announced, then it would start affecting them right away, potentially. Right? So in these models, you actually have to take a stand when you do policy analysis about when did people learn about the policy. And when things are a surprise, you have to solve the model two ways, like without the policy, and then once it's announced. You know, so those are some things you have to think about in a dynamic context, which you wouldn't normally have to think about in a static context. Like whether people knew the policy was coming. I mean, it can be kind of an issue. Like I'm dealing with some like changes to a pension reform, and probably a lot of people didn't know about it. You know, so people may not be reacting right away because it takes them a while to learn about things. You know, and oftentimes we don't know in the data if people knew about the policy or not. So. Okay, so the only additional parameter was this discount factor, and even though this W, that's the difference in the Emaxes, that's also a function of omega, the same state space. The reason we're able to separate this from this, see, this omega has all these elements in it, but it has them in there in a very non-linear way, you know, that comes from the functional form specification. And that's why we're able to separate out this discount factor, because of the functional form assumptions here. Because if this were totally linear like this, then you couldn't, you know, separate out these things. So there's only one additional parameter in the dynamic model versus the static model here. Okay. So we can do all the same policy experiments that we did in the static model. Sorry, I tell you about these things sometimes, but before I show you the slide, but see. So the effect on the current participation decision, it'll depend on like whether you anticipate the policy coming in, that's all. Okay, so if it were a surprise, then you have to resolve the program with and without the policy, right? So it's more work if it's a surprise, because then you have to solve the model that they don't know about it, and then once they know about it. So computationally, it's a little more work to have a policy that's a surprise. Because a policy that's pre-announced that people know about their whole lifetime, you have to only solve the dynamic programming problem once. But if it's a surprise, you have to solve it like, you know, with and without the policy. But only back to the announcement time period. Okay. All right. So there, in the literature, people make different assumptions on the shocks, and there are kind of like different schools of thought about how to do this. Like John Rust, he often makes these like IID Weibull assumptions that give rise to logits. I mean, in the stuff I do, it's more normality assumptions. You know, so sometimes the papers are making, it's more for computational reasons. It's not, well, actually some of this is one reason the IID, to get the logit advantages, you have to assume additivity a lot of times. So, but there is this advantage, I guess, to doing, this is called a conditional choice probability approach. So what John Rust showed here is that you can write the probability that you work in the last period. It has this under the logit assumption, or the Weibull assumption that gives rise to the logit, the Emax expression actually has a closed form. So if I assume normality, it never has a closed form, because normal, you always, you know, not even the normal CDF has a closed form, right? It always has integrals. And so you always have to use numerical methods to integrate over normal shocks. But if I assume IID, like Weibull, and then I get this logit, I can actually write a closed form expression for the Emax equation, right? And the Emax ends up being this, rho is the joint, here. This is this parameter in the, this is the Weibull, I think. e to the minus e to the minus u over p. But so the advantage of doing it this way is if I estimate the probability of working at different state space elements, I can actually then get the Emax from that. And that's called the conditional choice probability approach, because this is a conditional choice probability. And what people do in the literature sometimes is they estimate this in a flexible way. They try to be kind of non-parametric about how they estimate this. This is, I think Hutz and Miller maybe was the first paper that did this. And then they come up with this Emax equation that's a function of this P. Okay, and so the advantage is there's no integrals because it's closed form. Okay, and then you can actually back out. So this is the Emax at earlier time periods. So you also solve it backwards, but you never have to evaluate any integrals. But this approach requires that you evaluate the probability of working here. And you have to do that at every time period. So a limitation of doing it this way is you need data on people at every time period. Like your data has to actually span the whole time period. Otherwise, you couldn't get this. But this is a popular method. And I think now they're using this in I.O. I mean, I haven't myself been using this, so. But I think it's gotten to be kind of popular. In I.O., they're doing dynamic models with multiple agents. And so the state space, like the different agents could be different firms interacting in a dynamic setting. And so then the state space element includes not only characteristics of that firm, but also of all the other firms. So it gets, some of the models get pretty complicated. And I think there the conditional choice probability approach leads to some computational simplifications that people are taking advantage of. But there is a trade-off because you have to assume additivity normally, and you need data that covers the whole, all the time periods in order to be able to get this. Okay, and it doesn't, I know it doesn't look simpler, but I think it's a lot faster to do this way because you don't have to numerically evaluate integrals like using Monte Carlo methods. Okay. But it's also backward recursion. The only difference is that there's a closed form solution for the Emax functions that you would not get with normality. Okay. But sometimes it's problematic to have like additive shocks. Like for this example, ideally we want to have log wage instead of wage being linear. And if I introduce log, then I lose this additivity. So sometimes it doesn't make sense in certain applications to have extreme value additive errors. Like it just doesn't make sense, you know. So it depends on your model whether you'd want to do this or not. Okay. So this is an approach that's often used in these types of models. So I would say a big limitation is this IID shocks. You know, because in reality, shocks are usually correlated. Like wage shocks are highly correlated for individuals. You know, usually you're in the same job. So your wage may be exactly the same from one period to the next. And so assuming the shocks are purely IID, sometimes within these types of models, you end up getting too much movement in and out of states. You know, it's hard to capture that there's a lot of state dependence, that people tend to stay in the same state for a long time. So in order to capture that, there are two options. So you could either introduce serially correlated shocks, like assume like an AR1 process instead of IID, right? But that creates complications because the state space then has to include lagged shocks, right? So that's a big complication because lagged shocks are a continuous variable. And remember, I have to evaluate the Emax at all the elements of the state space. So that becomes a lot harder, and it's impossible for continuous variables. So, but there are methods to deal with it. But another option is to assume something like a fixed effect in the shock structure. So you're familiar with fixed effects for panel data models, right? Where you have like a fixed effect error structure. Well, in duration analysis, there was this approach that Heckman and Singer proposed in 81. And this is where they assume that the population consists of a fixed number of types. So a fixed effect would be like everybody being their own type, right? So we're not going to be that flexible, but we could say like maybe there are three types in the population. So everybody is one of those types. And so these shocks then, so here actually this notation says there are M types of women and M types of men, okay? And we assume that each type has like a different, the shock consists of a permanent component which relates to the type plus a time-varying component that's IID. So then, like in a wage equation, some might be a high type that they always get high wages. You know, and that could be like unobservability, for example, just leading to high wages in all time periods. And the benefit of doing this, it introduces permanence in the shocks. You know, but type then becomes part of the state space. So it's another unobserved component, a discrete type. But this is called like a discrete unobserved type. And it's included in these models to capture unobserved heterogeneity across people. And you could do this for the, well this, remember epsilon was a preference shock, and this eta here is the wage shock. Okay, so you could introduce types wherever you wanted to, in the wage equation, and in the preferences, potentially. Okay, I like to think of it like a fixed effect, except we're restricting the fixed effect to only be like one of three values, something like that. Yeah. All right, so in the model, then we'd assume that the couple knows their type, but we don't know it. So we have to integrate out over the unobserved type. But the main reason for doing this is just to incorporate more permanence in the unobservable component. Without it, it's hard to fit certain types of behaviors. You know, like if I fit this labor supply model that I just showed you and I didn't have any unobserved heterogeneity, I probably would get too many people bouncing in and out of work. You know, and then I compare it to the data and there's more permanence in the data. You know, like they don't work and then they work, you know, something like that in the data. Whereas in my simulation, I'd get working, not working, you know, like too much movement. So introducing some permanence in the shocks through this approach, it's like computationally pretty easy. You know, that serial correlated shocks would accomplish the same thing, but computationally it's harder because it makes the state space very large to put in the lag shocks. And the likelihood, what you then have to do is you integrate out over the unobserved types. So now I have to actually solve the likelihood for each type, and then I have some probability associated with each type. Okay. So computationally, if I have like two types, I have to now solve the likelihood twice. One if you're type one, one if you're type two. And then I don't know which type you are, so I estimate like a probability associated with each type. So if you do duration analysis, it's the same as what they do, like the Heckman-Singer approach in those types of models.
This is just for understanding. So does that mean you allow all the parameters to vary with the types, or is it more like an additive random error?
You could, if you wanted, you can put type in anywhere, like once you allow for type dependence. But normally, people would just introduce type as like an additive effect in the wage equation or in the preference. But you could even let slopes depend on type. Yeah. In fact, we don't really know what's the best type of assumption. People try to be more parsimonious, not to add too many parameters, and that's why it's normally just included as like a shift in the intercept. Okay. All right, well, I guess, so this is what I was saying, that you could assume AR1, but then the state space would have to include lagged shocks, you know, because now the previous shock is informative about future shocks once you have an AR1 process. So instead of just including a discrete type, now you're actually adding a continuous variable, which is the realized value of the lagged shock. And that's what makes it more difficult computationally to do it this way, okay? So serial correlation augments the state space. And some people do this anyway, so like after the break, I'll kind of describe what you can do if you have a large state space. So I'm not saying it's impossible, I'm just saying computationally it's hard.
Just for understanding that, do you make assumptions about the differences between the types?
No, I mean, you wouldn't assume like that one type is better or anything like that, but then when you estimate the whole model, then you would see from your parameters, type one has a higher wage than type two.
But you specify a number of types, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to, there's some literature that tries to, you know, somehow endogenously determine number, but then actually the model becomes, then it's not a parametric model. Like if you would let the number types, you know, go to infinity, and it affects inference a lot. You have to use like different theorems and everything. So they don't normally do that. Normally people would just specify, I mean, what happens in practice, okay, like maybe I assume two types and I see the model doesn't fit that well, then I say, well, maybe I need another type. You know, like in practice, there's like kind of a lot of iteration between specifying the model, checking how well it fits, and then going back and maybe making some changes to the model, you know. Which, I mean, it's a little bit problematic from the point of view of, you know, standard errors at the end of the whole procedure, but because the models are pretty complicated, it's kind of hard to anticipate ahead of time which aspects are not going to fit, you know. So if I did labor supply and then I saw people are bouncing in and out, then I might say, oh, I need some types, you know, and then maybe it still didn't fit that well, then it, with two types, then I might say, well, I'll try three types, and then it might fit well, you know, like, but in the end, you'll get type proportions from this. So there are extra parameters here. This is proportion each type. So I'll see in the end, like, 60% of the population is type 1, you know, 30% is type 2, and 10% is type 3. Like, I would get that from the estimation. That's, these parameters here would tell me that. So, but ahead of time, I wouldn't say type 1 loves to work, you know, something like that. That would come out of the estimation. Yeah. Okay, so let's take a break for half an hour then. State dependence of the kind that we see in the data are basically you introduce some permanent heterogeneity called these discrete unobserved types. This is usually called unobserved heterogeneity in this literature, or else you can introduce some serial independence or serial dependence in the shocks, like with an AR1 error structure, you know, but the drawback of this approach is that it enlarges the state space. So a general problem in these types of models is the large state space that you can get. And depending on the decision problem, it can get very huge. Like, for example, we had a model where we were modeling the decision to send a child to school, but it was families in Mexico and they had a lot of kids. So they could have in our model up to 8 children, and we wanted it to vary by gender. You know, so, and then we also modeled fertility, and so, you know, every time period you could have a child, and then you could decide for 8 different children whether to send them to school or to put them at work or to keep them home. So, you know, it's like 2 to the 3rd plus all the fertility decisions. So it gets to be very large number of choices, And then also, if you want to keep track of like the schooling for all the different children, and the ages of all the different children, then your state space can get to be really large. You know, so we need some methods of dealing with large state spaces. So in the problem I showed you earlier, it was the state space was just a number of years of experience that the woman has, right? That was the only, you know, plus whatever, maybe N number of kids she has, but if that's not changing over time, the years of experience in the first time period, it's just zero, you know, then it's zero or one, then it's zero, one or two, you know, then it's zero, one, two or three, and that's how the state space evolved. So that was manageable, because even, you know, later on it's maybe 50 or something, but it's still something we can handle with a computer. But I'll show you some problems where the state space gets to be pretty large. And if it's continuous, you know, of course we need some method for accommodating that, because then you can't even evaluate it at every point in the state space. And that's called the curse of dimensionality. Just the fact that the state space, two problems really, you have large state space and large number of choices too sometimes. And it grows exponentially too. Like for example, in this experience example, you know, the state spaces gain larger because there are more and more possible experience values that the woman could have. So there are two ways to deal with this. Like either you have to keep the decision problem manageable, you know, to really make sure your state space doesn't get too large. Or else, the second approach is you can abandon trying to get an exact solution to the dynamic programming problem and instead try to get an approximate solution. So there are a few different approximation approaches in the literature. So I'll describe some of them just to give you an idea. So, well, I mean, this is the method that I usually use, but this is discretization. So if you have continuous variables, for example, you can just draw a set of a subset of those variables, like just draw some values, and then you evaluate these Emax functions on this grid of discrete values, okay? And then you can interpolate between the grid points, or else you can, like restrict the state variables so they stay on the discrete grid. So I actually have papers that do both of these things. So one is like a savings model, where of course in reality savings is a continuous choice, you know, but we just assume that you can save like 0%, 5%, 10%, 15%, that the savings has to correspond to some discrete grid. You know, and then over time, that allows for many different savings possibilities, but it limits the number of savings options and then also limits the state space in that way. And then I'll describe interpolation procedures. There are a few different methods here for doing this, but this idea is you randomly subset, or let's say you have 10,000 possible state points. You randomly choose 2,000 from those 10,000. And then you evaluate the Emaxes at those 2,000 points, and then you run a regression of the Emaxes on the state variables, and then you use that regression for interpolation at other values. So that would be like a regression interpolation method, right? So you don't evaluate, because it's computationally difficult to evaluate the Emax. That first stage of solving the dynamic programming problem is the part that's computationally intensive. So you can do that just at a subset of the state points and then use a regression model to interpolate to other points. You know, because we really need it at all the state points, but we could evaluate it like at, you know, a quarter of them or something and then interpolate at the other values. Okay, so that method was proposed by, originally by Bellman. So these types of models are used a lot in other literatures, you know, not just economics. So they're used in engineering and physics. I even found out my dad did this. That was a little scary, actually, because he told me what he did for his master's thesis, and he said he solved a Bellman equation in Fortran. I was like, what do you think I'd do, you know? It was like amazingly similar to what I do. But and that was in physics. So these methods are used in different fields. But Keen and Wolpin were the first to propose this approximation and interpolation approach, you know, in economics for these types of models. Okay, and you can either use them when you have continuous state variables or else when you have a large number of discrete variables that make it hard to evaluate the Emaxes at all these different points. I mean, as computers get better and better, you know, we're able to solve bigger problems. You know, so nowadays, with parallel processing machines, we solve a lot of these models using multiprocessor machines. You know, so you use like 200 processors at the same time. You know, and so there are different ways of parallelizing these programs, but that actually makes a lot of models feasible that before were not feasible at all. You know, so the advances in computer science have helped a lot for estimating these types of models. But with any interpolation method, you have to, well, there's some literature on non-parametric interpolation, but usually people just use parametric regression interpolation, you know, and you have to do, it's like you run a linear regression at every time period when you're solving the model backwards. So to solve the Emaxes, you're basically keeping track of these regression coefficients at every time period. Right. So you know how you need the Emax values at every state point. Well, if you have a regression that describes that, then once you have the regression coefficients, that gives you the Emax interpolation at all possible state points. So you have to like store the coefficients from that regression. And you need that regression to fit pretty well, because you're doing it backwards, so you're repeatedly using it. You know, so normally we have to look at some fit criteria, because if you have a bad regression in period T, that gets used over and over again for all the previous time periods, you know. So normally we would look at like R squares and try and make the R squares really high for the interpolation, you know, but there's not actually a lot of literature on how to do this in the best way. So this is an area that's kind of unknown exactly what's the best method for different types of models. I'm going to skip this. It's described in our handbook chapter in more detail, but I haven't seen that many people applying this method. So usually, I would say the most common method is just this using regression interpolation to get the Emax at all possible state points. But this is how you would incorporate like an AR1 error structure, because then the lagged error, you could evaluate it at a bunch of different discrete values of the lag, and then you can interpolate to other values. Right? So you can accommodate continuous state variables using an interpolation approach. Okay. And there are very few papers that actually compare different methods. I mean, we only found this one. Well, there is this paper an older paper by Keen and Wolpin, where they have, this is their 94 paper, where they have a model where they had no interpolation, and then they also solved the model with interpolation, you know, using different numbers of state points to see how reliable is the interpolation for different numbers of draws of state points. You know, and they found that it performed pretty well. But that was for their specific model, you know, which was, I think, a schooling model, right? That model. And so we don't really know. Like, I've been lately estimating some savings models, you know, and we don't know in different types of models. Like, in the savings model, we found that a linear interpolation did not perform very well. You actually had to enter the regressors of the interpolation in a, like, our state variables were things like wealth, you know, because it was a savings model. And you had to enter wealth in the same functional form as it appeared in the utility function, kind of nonlinear did much better for interpolation. You know, so we don't really have enough evidence on what types of interpolations are best for what types of problems, you know, or even how many state points do you need to get a good interpolation. I think John Rust had some approaches where you don't randomize the state points. You actually pick in a little more systematic way that he said was better than random, you know, to cover the state space more fully. So there's some literature just on how best to do these Emacs interpolations. Okay, but that's how we're able to solve this curse of dimensionality, is by using some sort of interpolation method. Okay, so now I wanted to describe to you a model that is closer to something that you could actually get published. Because the other model was just too simple, like, do you work or not, you know? And so this model is going to allow now for the additional margin of, like, how many hours do you work? I think it also allows for fertility, actually. Okay, so we're going to have more than two alternatives, and it's straightforward to extend it. You know, just like if you had a binary choice versus a multinomial choice, and then you could use like a multinomial logit or a multinomial probit. So it's the same, that you could extend it to more choices than just two. And then you have k minus one latent variable functions if you have k choices. So these are going to be the choices. Four labor force alternatives corresponding to different hours. We're going to drop the assumption that errors are additive, because for wages, usually we assume log wages are additive. Because if you empirically look at wages, they don't have a normal distribution. They have more of a like a Pareto distribution. And so log wages look normal. So that's why people normally do log wages. Plus all the mincer stuff, you know, that gave you log wages. Okay, so let's say we were trying to model labor supply of, it doesn't have to be white married women. I think this is just some early data sets that were used for these types of problems. And then the woman is deciding to work, like not work at all, to work less than 500 hours. That's the first one, I guess. Less than 500, 500 to 1499 hours, 1500 to, you know, 2499, and work more than 2500 hours. Okay, and within this type of model, you could analyze things like a earned income tax credit, or, you know, there's sometimes taxes that depend on how many hours you work, you know, so you could introduce, instead of a childcare subsidy, you could, like, change the tax code. That would be another type of policy where you might want to know how many hours the woman's working. And then she'll have a fertility decision. Does she have a birth or not each year? So I think these models are really nice for modeling fertility, because that's definitely a dynamic decision, right? Do you have a child or not? You're thinking about the future normally. Okay. Usually, I would recommend before you go out and program up a model is to do just, we call these sometimes approximate decision rules, but it's kind of just kind of a reduced form between the choice variables and the state variables, just to verify that there is a relationship, you know, because you don't want to waste, you know, a year of your life programming and waiting for it to converge, and then turns out you don't see any relationships, you know. So normally you would do some exploratory analysis beforehand, like verify that the working decisions and fertility decisions are related to what you think of are the important state variables. You know, just do like probits, you know, do you have a child or not each age, and just see how they're related. So it's pretty common, even in these papers that estimate these models, to report some reduced form results before you report the results of the full model. Okay, so we'll assume that the couple gets this utility that depends now on how many hours are worked and how many children she has. And you need, in order for the likelihood to not be degenerate, so degenerate likelihood means that you see things in the data that are impossible under your model, right? So if there's anything in your data that your model cannot explain in any way, that would lead to degeneracy, okay? And actually, there are a lot of macro models that have degenerate likelihoods because a lot of times they don't estimate the models and they don't even think about this problem that much. But you need that your model could explain every observation in the data, especially when you're dealing with micro data because we're trying to fit the micro patterns, right? So that means for people with the same observables, like suppose I see two people that have the same observed state space, but one has a child and the other one doesn't, right? Even though their omega, the omega minus is the same. So the only way I could explain that is that one got a preference shock that led them to have a child and the other one didn't, right? So that's why I need a preference shock pretty much on each choice. So now that we have these multiple labor supply choices, we need to have a preference shock on each choice. Okay, so that's what these epsilons are. And we'll assume they're mutually serially uncorrelated, but incorporate these unobserved types. And so this is the unobserved type heterogeneity. Okay. And then each period, she's deciding labor supply and fertility. So there could be a newborn each period. Okay, so the budget constraint. So one thing within this model, you know, younger women tend to have more children, and it's partly for biological reasons that they just have higher fertility. And of course, in the economic model, it doesn't really capture the biology, right, of why it is that at different ages, people are just, you know, higher probability of having a birth. So what we can do is we can kind of incorporate that in the model by introducing a cost, like a cost of avoiding a birth that could just depend directly on age. So this is kind of to capture the age patterns that may be just related to pure biology that are not in here. Like if you had some measure of how fertile people are at different ages, maybe you could just put that in here instead, you know, or some hormones or something that determine fertility. But if we don't have that, you know, you can just incorporate like an age cost of avoiding a birth. So the cost would be declining as she gets older, and that kind of captures the fact that she has fewer births as she gets older. Okay, and then you can also introduce costs of like supplying children with consumption goods. That's just cost of having a child. And then you could have additional childcare costs associated with working. Okay, so it's a little more complicated, but it's basically a similar budget constraint. This is husband's income. This is the wage, which now she can choose different hours. So this is actually the median hours within each of those categories. And let's see, because it discretized the hours decision. You know, I mean, you could like draw hours or something if you wanted, but this is just assigning the median within each. This is the biological cost of avoiding a birth. I think this is age. This here is a cost per child, and this is a cost per child that depends on how many hours she works. So this would be like the childcare cost. And here we're actually distinguishing kids of different ages. So if she has an older child, you know, maybe that child can go to school, so the childcare cost is lower. You know, so this is now incorporating a lot more realism about the problem, right? How old are the kids and how many hours she's working? So it's more detail. And then the wage offer equation, we could assume depends on the mother's schooling level and on how many, on her experience level, which could be how many hours she worked. And sometimes people also introduce like recent working behaviors. So how many hours worked in the previous period. And then this is the wage shock, and we could also allow that to be type dependent. OK, Okay. And this is a returns to, this actually, this is called a human capital pricing equation because we're specifying the, here, let me just, there are different ways of interpreting a wage function, but if I just say wage is the return to human capital times the quantity of human capital that a person has, right? That's kind of a, that's called like a human capital pricing equation, right? And so we're modeling this as a function of her experience, her schooling, and then in logs, when I take logs, I get log of the price plus log of the quantity here. And so that's what I have here. It's like log of the price of working. We're here, we're actually, you know, the more hours you work, the bigger your wage, because it's like an hourly wage kind of. And that second part is like this log of H. It's the human capital equation. So this is like a human capital production function, the second part. Okay, so this is different from the Mincer interpretation.
I have a question about like the hours and the wage. So you're using like yearly hours because the time, like the index of the problem is yearly, is per year. And then the wage should be per week.
Yeah, you could use weekly hours, but I mean, yeah, in this model, the decision period is annual.
For that reason, the hours are annual, you know, and the wages are per week, or?
Well, the wages, no, it would have to be like annual wages. So if she reported weekly, we'd have to have a way of scaling up. Yeah. So the decision period is annual. Sometimes if you're modeling like job search behavior, usually they have shorter decision periods, like it might be monthly or quarterly. I've even seen some of these dynamic models. Like I looked at one recently, Donna Galeski had a decision model of whether you go to work when you're sick, you know, or whether you go to the doctor, or whether you stay home, or whether you just go to the office sick. So it was actually a daily model, because every day, she had like work histories about sicknesses and stuff. So it was a dynamic model, but it was day by day. So you have to choose some time period, and then everything has to correspond to that time period. Okay, then husbands, we could also specify our earnings equation for husbands. You know, if we wanted to, it could be a function of his schooling, his age. So in this model, it's only the woman's deciding whether to work. I mean, I'm actually currently working on something where the woman and the man are deciding on working, you know, because it has retirement behavior. So they're deciding whether to retire together, stuff like that. Okay, so the time-varying state variables, the number of children, because the cost of daycare varies with the age of the child, we have to keep track of the children's ages. So this is going to be the number of kids age like 0 to 5. And it depends on when they were born. So this is like they were born 1 year ago or up to 5 years ago. So little n is an indicator for do you have a birth or not. And then this is kids age 6 to 17. Then this is how the number of children evolves, you know, because now that's a decision. But fertility is a binary decision. So in this model, it's assumed that if you want a child, you can have one. But you could also, like right now I'm working on a different problem where we have decisions about sexual behavior and contraception. So you could just decide to be active and to use contraception or not. You know, so you could actually not necessarily assume that you directly are deciding on kids. You could have, you know, kids come stochastically as a function of your other decisions about sexual behavior. So there are a few papers try to model that, especially like for teenage fertility, you know, that they're choosing to be active and they're not using contraception, stuff like that. And then this is experience, so number of hours that the woman worked in in total. This is like based on the previous period. Okay, so now you see this model is much richer than the other model, right? The choice set, she's got four working alternatives plus the decision whether to have a child or not. So there are eight choices during the periods where she could have a child. When the woman gets older, you know, there usually comes some age when people, to make the model simpler, partly, you know, we'd assume beyond some age she only chooses work and the number of kids is fixed. So then it would be like four choices. Okay, fecund means whether she's able to have children or not. Okay, so it's either she has four choices or eight choices, depending on her age in this model. Okay, but otherwise the setup's the same. Everything is pretty much the same. We have more shocks, you know, because now we have the preference shocks associated with the working options, plus the fertility preference shock, plus the wage offer shock for the wife and for the husband. You know, so there are actually six shocks altogether in the model. And usually we would assume, you know, that some shocks might be independent of each other you could have a sixth variant normal, but then you have a lot of covariance terms, you know, so we'd normally place some covariance restrictions, like the shock to women's wages and men's wages are independent, and maybe independent of the preference shocks as well. Okay, but it's still solved all the same way by backwards recursion. The Emaxes have to be calculated. It's just that now it's a six variant integral, you know, so because we have six shocks. So that's a little more complicated. And the state space is all feasible values of these things. Okay, so it's a bigger state space.
Is there any other constraint on the number of children other than the cost of supplying them with goods?
You could put a max. You could say, oh, she can only have, I mean, that's probably a good idea. Except the Duggars in the U.S.
If it's high enough, then the would mean that the mother would just get as many children as possible?
If the wages, well, high wage would lead her to, let's see. Children are a normal good. So like if the husband has a lot of income, she'd want more kids normally.
If you just make the childcare subsidy high enough so that you actually get money back, mm-hmm. Then mothers would choose infinite numbers of children,
yeah.
Which might be a bit problematic.
Yeah. Well, it depends. You know, you have to estimate these parameters. You probably wouldn't get that. I mean, that would be an implication if you, like, I think in Germany, they give families money per child, right? Like, and some other countries do this too, you know, because the fertility rate is pretty low. And so a lot of countries, like Sweden too, they're trying to stimulate fertility. So you could put that in this sort of model. In fact, I think it would be very interesting. I haven't seen any applications. Have you seen? I haven't seen where they actually try to model these subsidies to having children in a lot of European countries and see what effect that has. And then you could actually vary the subsidy. And you could even do like for the first child, for the second child, for the third child, because I think the subsidy varies with the parity of the child. So it's true, theoretically, you could get infinite number of children, but probably once you estimate the model and you get the parameters, that would be like a crazy implication if you went way outside your data, you know? And you could very easily impose a constraint. If you wanted to put a biological constraint that the woman can only have like five children, you could do that, you know? That's probably a good idea because you don't want to have to get the Emaxes at, you know, 20 kids. It just computationally, it makes it hard. So like for Mexico, we put eight kids. Because we did actually have families with seven or eight kids in our data, even more. But we just ignored more than eight kids. Okay, But you see that this problem is complicated enough that the number of possible birth sequences is huge. So it's infeasible to do the full solution. So we have to do some sort of interpolation. You know, because there are too many possible combinations of kids of different ages that you could have that make the state space really large. Okay, so we have to use the interpolation method. We can interpolate based on regression. You know, so you'd calculate the Emax at some random subsample of the points and then interpolate for other points. Okay, so this is like if the woman is not having kids, the Emax is going to be taking the maximum over four possible choices she can make. Okay. And then these expectations, if you do normality, you have to use Monte Carlo integration. So there's also a literature on what's the best way to do this Monte Carlo integration, which actually I need to invest more time to learn about better methods, because I normally do kind of just very simple methods, but I think there's some different sampling methods that are better than this. Like one of my colleagues works, like Jesus Fernandez Villaverde actually works on like high dimensional integration problems, how you get reliable estimates. But here you have to choose, you know, D, like how many Monte Carlo draws. But basically what you do is you repeatedly draw shocks from the error distribution. So let's say I did this 100 times. For those 100 sets of shocks, I figure out what's the maximum utility, and then I just take the average. And that's a numerical way of integrating over these shocks. Right, so that would be Monte Carlo integration. So Monte Carlo is used in different stages in estimating these models. So that's one stage, is just in getting the Emax. Okay, and now after I do that, I have all the Emax. I can do this for different state points, omega. But because my state space is so large, I would typically just choose a random subsample of omega and then interpolate, you know, do an interpolating regression. So I take all those Emaxes that I got, and then I run a regression of those on the state variables to come up with this interpolating function so that I can get the Emax at any possible state points that I want. Okay. All right. And then once I have that Emax, then I solve the model backwards and I do it all over again. Then I get the Emax at the previous time period and I do the interpolation again. Okay. All right, so you continue this procedure, you get all the Emax functions, all the interpolating regressions. At some point, we'll get back to the point where the mother has the option of having the birth of the child, you know, and then she has an additional, so then the Emax, you get over eight possibilities instead of four. You know, but otherwise the procedure is the same. You draw the shocks, you just figure out the maximum utility, take the average over all the shocks. Okay, so now I wanted to describe how you do it when it's not analytical, because normally the problems are more complicated and you can't write down the analytical solution, as in this model. It's, you know, a little more complicated. So even to do maximum likelihood, we could use simulation methods. Okay, so we draw shocks, and we can define this set. This is a set of shocks that would make HN the optimal choice, given this state space. So remember, in setting up the likelihood, we need this probability, right? And this probability is all those shocks that would lead you to make that choice, 0, 0. Okay. So what we can do is also do this through simulation. So you just draw shocks here, and you look, okay, so first of all, we already solved the dynamic program. So that's, you know, that was the other slides. That was all solving. This is now the likelihood part. So it's like the, you know, once you have all the Emaxes, now we do this. Okay, so we have all the ingredients to get these value functions. Now we use the simulation at another stage. We look, so this is called simulated maximum likelihood. So we draw shocks, and then, you know, maybe you draw 1,000 shocks or 500 shocks, and then you look what fraction of the time was 0, 0 the optimal choice. Okay. So let's say in reality, in the data, we saw them choosing 0, 0. And then we look how often was 0, 0 the optimal choice under the model. This is an indicator for that the optimal choice under the model was 0, 0. Okay? And the fraction of times in these random set of shocks that they actually choose 0, 0, given your model, that's going to be the probability of choosing 0, 0, like under your model. Okay, and so we can use this in the likelihood. You can also estimate like a binary choice model this way. Like if you had a probit, just a simple probit, you know, one thing is you write the analytical probit model. The other thing is you could just simulate, draw normal shocks, look at the fraction of time people chose 1 versus 0, and use that as your probability. So you could even do a simple probit model using simulated maximum likelihood if you wanted, you know. And it's used like for multinomial probit models usually. So simulation, I just wanted you to get a sense it's used at different stages. Like it's used in solving the dynamic program, and it's also used in simulating the likelihood. You know, so this Monte Carlo, you know, drawing the shocks is used multiple places. And so we would do that for every possible choice under the model. For the working options, we also see the wage, but we can decompose this into the probability given the wage times the probability of the wage. So this is the joint probability of the working decision plus the wage, and we would typically solve it by writing it as these two things separately. This we usually have an analytical equation for, and this part you would do through simulation. All right, and so if this is additive, we can write down the analytical equation here. So this is just these two parts. So it's this part plus this part, and then this part we could solve through simulation. And this part is like just the wage part. Okay. Let's see. So this is just solving through simulation the same way. We just draw shocks and we look now how often she chose 2, 1. That means she had a child and she chose working option number 2. You know, so you can do this for each of the things. We have to assume for simulated maximum likelihood that the number of draws goes to infinity. So this is like McFadden, I think, is the main reference discussing like simulated. Turns out for simulated method moments, you don't have to assume the number of draws goes to infinity. McFadden has a famous paper about that. But this is all in theory. You know, in practice, you just have to pick an M. But it turns out that even with this assumption, you can actually improve the performance of the simulator. And the reason is that this indicator function here is non-smooth, you know, the indicator function, because it's like, it's an indicator like this. And so what they do is, if I make it smooth, instead of, the idea is that instead of like this, I just smooth it out into something that's continuous, like that. That actually improves the performance of the estimator. So that was something that McFadden showed, you know, a long time ago, even for like some simple static models. And so what people normally do is use use what's called McFadden's smooth simulator, but it's basically just replacing the indicator function. See, that kind of looks like a CDF. So people usually use like a logit CDF in place of the indicator function. Okay, and you normally have this additional smoothing parameter that you make smaller and smaller, and as you make that smaller, it comes closer and closer to the indicator function. That this has come up in a few different places. Like there's also an econometrica paper by Horowitz showing that when you introduce smoothing into Mansky's maximum score estimator, it actually makes the asymptotics much better. So sometimes just smoothing things out improves performance. So instead of using just this indicator function, this is just a fraction of times that they chose this. What people normally use is this McFadden smooth simulator. You know, but all you have to do to get this is you say, what choice was maximal under my model? And then what was the value function for the choice I see them making? So if I see the person make 2-1 as their choice, you know, I figure out what was the optimal choice under my model for that draw, and then I compute this for each of the draws, this object, and then take the average over all the draws. And this is what I was saying is the smoothing parameter, like tau. Okay, so the main purpose of doing this is just to improve performance of the estimator, of the maximum likelihood estimator, by making it smoother. I mean, actually, McFadden had some Monte Carlo studies where he showed that this improved the performance. It's pretty, it's like from the 80s, so it's pretty old now. But this is how you could calculate for the maximum likelihood. So this is instead of the analytical, right? In the earlier example, we had analytical expressions for these things, but now this is all done through simulation. Because you can't get analytical expressions when the errors are not additive and the model's more complicated. And actually, it's simpler to do with this way anyways, because when you do everything analytical, it's easy to make a mistake in the derivation somewhere, whereas just computational is pretty easy. It's just computer time to do it. But there are decisions you have to make, like how big is M? How big is D when I do the integration, you know? And usually you have to kind of check sensitivity to this. Okay, so I would say the main limitation in estimating these models is computational burden. And then in addition, on top of this, we need an optimization algorithm, right, to solve the maximum likelihood because it's searching over parameters. So in addition to all this, you know, which is basically programming, and then I don't know of any existing software because the problems are kind of model specific. So I don't think there's any like package software available maybe eventually we'll have different types of models like in Stata for different types of problems, but right now, I think pretty much you have to kind of program it yourself. So you could do using MATLAB. I think Stata would be too hard, I don't think it lets you customize the code enough to really program it yourself that easily in Stata. So I would recommend MATLAB, Fortran, C. I mean, I know now a lot of people are using like Julia at Penn, although I haven't tried this yet, but it's like the newest language people are using. Python, you know, so there are a lot of different options for programming, but I don't think there's a lot of packaged software. I think you actually have to program the likelihood yourself pretty much to do these things. Okay. So the computational burden is kind of the main issue. And the one method that's an alternative, so the way I described it is how I often do it. You know, I usually do it kind of brute force, doing these Monte Carlo integrations and assuming normality. But But this Hutz-Miller approach I was talking about earlier, it does not require this numerical integration. And actually, they have a recent econometrica paper where they relax the additivity assumption also. So they relax some of the assumptions of their original method. Well, not Hutz and Miller. It's actually Arcidiacono and Miller wrote a follow-up paper that appeared a few years ago in Econometrica that extended this method to allow for like non-additivity and also some other error distributions. But I mean, the main thing about this method, if you do have additivity, then you get the advantages that John Rust talked about, that you can write the Emacs as a function of this probability, and then their approach is to estimate this probability and use that to derive the Emacs. And I think it works well. I mean, I have grad students that do this, and they're able to do it successfully, and they like it. It's just I never tried it myself, so I don't really have personal experience. But a lot of people do use this method. It requires more of the data because you need to be able to estimate this at all possible values of the state space. So this method, you could not, like if your data only went to age 30 and your model went to age 50, then it wouldn't work because you actually need the data to cover all the periods of your model to be able to estimate this. So, you know, but computationally, you don't have all this Monte Carlo integration, you know, so it's a little simpler. And I think in I/O, this method has gotten to be popular lately. Aguirre-Biria, I think, in Pedro Mira, that they have a paper on applying these CCP methods in I/O models. So. All right. Okay, but I would say, you know, you don't have to know the details or anything, but that this is a way of reducing the computational burden. That's the main, this Arcidiacono and Miller is the most recent approach here. Okay. So now would be the time when I would switch to the other slides. So we need a couple minutes because of the video to switch slides. Are there any questions?
It's probably more like practical question compared to the first part, Travis. So in fact, it's usually a problem that's hard to find in a true description that's convincing. So there has been a paper by Satori, I don't know whether you know it, that is on a binary sample selection problem. And this model is identified by the fact that the errors that are driving the selection and the outcome equation are assumed to be correlated highly in the same direction. Mm-hmm. And this paper has been out for like 10 or even more years, and I have not really seen it applied. So,
Satori. Oh,
Satori. Yeah. What do you think? Would it be possible to run like a Heckman type binary selection model without an exclusion restriction, and that would be credible?
I mean, I would say for the policy, if you wanted to do policy evaluation, I mean, I think in this model you need some sort of. I mean, they do have these alternative identification strategies that Heckman has worked on, like called identification at infinity, like where if you have certain groups of people for which there's no selection, like some people always go to college, you know, where you know there's no selectivity bias because there is no selection because they always make that choice. You can use those types of groups to identify certain parameters of your model, but usually those groups are kind of small, you know, because they have to have probability close to one of making certain choices. So it's controversial, I would say. Like in theory, there's some methods of identification that are different, you know, that wouldn't rely in the same way on exclusion restrictions, but but they're kind of controversial, so I wouldn't like recommend them necessarily. But I don't know this paper, Santori. So he's basically imposing restrictions on the covariance of the errors.
So I think she's a political scientist from Princeton, so she uses a perfect positive correlation in the error structure, or a negative one, but also shows that her approach is robust to the specification of this.
Okay, so that would be like in the wage equation, like the preference shock and the wage shock are perfectly correlated, something like that. So I would say the only difficulty there would be motivating why you're assuming that. Like if it would make sense in your application, you know that two shocks should be correlated in a certain way, then maybe, you know, you could do that. But in this context, it wouldn't make that much sense, right? That your wage shock would be correlated with your preference shock. So this next set of slides, we won't have time to cover all of the examples, but these are just going through some applications of the models. So let's see. So there have been a lot of labor supply models. And I would say the literature on men and on women has gone in somewhat different directions. The literature on male labor supply usually focuses on the hours decision and has oftentimes treated the hours decision as a continuous choice. So you could do these dynamic models with a continuous choice, but then you have to solve first order equations, right? Like hours could be continuous and then you solve the first order condition. And on men, usually they assume that they work and the choice has been just how much do you work? Right? Whereas for women, they've been modeling more the discrete feature, do you work or not? So the literature has been a little different, labor supply for men and for women. And fertility has played a bigger role, of course, in modeling the labor supply for women. We won't be able to cover all of these. So let's see, maybe I should, just as an overview, this was one of the earliest papers, the Eckstein and Wolpin paper. So this was just modeling like participation, then also here numbers of children in different age ranges in schooling. You know, and some of the, I think here they're not choosing N. They're just choosing like participation or not. So this is closer to what we were looking at. You know, a woman gets a wage if she participates. This is a husband's income. This is a cost per child and a participation cost of being in the labor market. So that's very close to what we already looked at. Let's see. You know, so they estimate it using 318 women. You know, so in 1989, I mean, I was around using computers and they were really bad, you know, so it's really impressive that they were able to, you know, do this type of model at all given the computers that were available like in the 80s. So they fixed the discount factor. In fact, even nowadays, a lot of times people fix the discount factor if they don't have a lot of time periods of data. You know, I mean, in macro, it's very common to calibrate and you fix lots of parameters in that case. But here, if you only have a few periods of data, then it can be difficult to estimate the discount factor. And so then sometimes it's fixed. And the rest of the model is estimated. You know, and so what did they get out of this? They found, that it made a big difference for the OLS wage. Oh, I should mention that when you estimate the wage offer equation along with the rest of the model, you are controlling for selection. You know, that it's automatically, because you're incorporating the full structure in the model, you are controlling for selection in estimating the wage equation. You know, like you wouldn't have to separately do the wage equation as like a Heckman two-step or something. I mean, in fact, it doesn't even make sense to do it separately because a lot of times doing it separately, the decision model for whether you work or not is the complete model. You know, so you can't really estimate the wage equation outside of the model. And people do that sometimes, but it's not really theoretically consistent. So it's usually better to estimate the wage equation, everything together with the model, because then the selectivity correction is the model that you're assuming. You know, So this is what they do with the model. They say, well, what if we gave the husband more income? You know, how would that affect the wife's working decision? If we gave the husband $10,000 more income, she'll work. So the baseline would be she'd work 5.9 years, but this data is kind of old, so it's not like modern data. If husband's earnings increase by 50%, the model predicts her participation rate will drop in half. So probably nowadays you wouldn't get this at all, you know, because high income women marry high income men. We've had an increase in assortative matching in the marriage market. But this is the type of thing that they do with the model. And then Vanderclaw, he extended this framework to include marriage as a choice. So you can also include marriage in these models. And in that case, women get a probability of a marriage offer. And then children arrive stochastically in a way that depend on state variables. So children, you could either make a choice or you could say they're stochastic. You know, and I mean, usually making them a choice is better, but I mean, unless you're really in an environment where they can't control their fertility, then maybe it's, you know, makes more sense that it's stochastic. Computationally, it can be a little easier sometimes to say it's stochastic. So I think that's why sometimes people assume it's just a random process and not a choice. Okay, but in his model, you have working and marriage decisions, and children just randomly arrive. But they're maybe more likely if you're married. Okay. So there's no specific match component. So the woman doesn't have an incentive to reject marriage offers, hoping that another one will come along. So these models, there are a lot of models that model marriage decisions too, using this type of framework. And then he looks at like an increase in women's wages. Does that lead her to delay marriage? So if he increases women's wages, she increases working, gets an increase in work experience, delays marriage on average by 1 year. Okay, and now this is a paper that now makes fertility a choice and allows for full-time and part-time work. So this is similar to the example I gave, but it assumes marriage is exogenous, so that women begin the model when they get married. So you could do that, just start the model at the age of marriage. To avoid having to put the husband's characteristics in the state space, they model the husband's characteristics as a function of the wife's characteristics, or husband's income as a function of wife's. So this is just to reduce the state space. I mean, it kind of makes sense because high education husbands are probably married to high education women, so it may not be that bad. All right, and then they have preference shock for children, they have error term and wage offer equation. They also incorporate additional measurement error. You could do that in these models. Use simulation methods like I described. They estimate it using the young women's survey here. Look at returns to education in the wage equation, find higher returns in the full-time wage than in the part-time wage, and then look at how changes in wages would affect labor supply. Okay, I mean, I just wanted to kind of give you some idea of how these models are being used, like what questions they can address. Okay, so this is a more recent paper, and this is kind of the best paper, I think, in the U.S. right now on effects of the welfare program. You know, because in the US, they had changes in, they had a big change in the welfare program. Because it used to be that you only got welfare if you didn't work, you know, and then they changed it to introduce all these work requirements. And they also introduced term limits that you can only get welfare for up to 5 years. It used to be that you could get it as long as, you know, you weren't working and didn't have income, you could get welfare. So there was a very big change in the U.S. welfare system. So they have a model using the NLSY data of marriage and fertility and full-time and part-time work and schooling. So this is kind of a recent paper, so computationally, you know, it's there are a lot more choices. And the women, you know, because some of them are still living with their parents, they could be co-residing with parents receiving parental support. They get wage offers, they decide whether to get married. Because there's concern that the welfare system has a disincentive to get married. You know, because if you get married, then you don't qualify for welfare anymore. You know, so they're looking at how powerful is this disincentive, you know, and also by race, like for black women versus white women. Because in the US, there are a lot more, there's a lot higher out of wedlock fertility for black women than for white women, and they don't know exactly why. So they're trying to look at why is that this racial difference. Okay. All right, so, and the welfare rules are changing over time and they differ by state. So they're incorporating the state-specific rules, but they only do it, so the way they do it is they characterize the welfare rules. So that would be like at what income level do you get welfare and how much do you have to earn for it to be phased out, you know? So women get utility from children, pregnancy, marriage, attending school, welfare participation, and leisure in their model. So it's 5 taste shocks. They incorporate 6 unobserved types. So that's a lot. I don't know exactly why they chose 6, but... and then they only estimate the model with, you know, these states because they were modeling the state-specific rules. So they just picked some very big states with a lot of population. And they actually leave out Texas. And the reason is they estimate the model with the other states, and then they look at how good is the fit for Texas. You know, and so they're basically... taking that as out-of-sample validation of the model. Because Texas, it turns out, was more extreme than the other states in terms of the rules. You know, so that's kind of like really going out of sample to see how the model works for Texas. Okay. And they find, actually, I didn't make any copies, but they find some, it does pretty well for Texas. So this paper was published in IER. So they increase wage offers for all 6 types. They find a lot of heterogeneity in responses. That increased wage offers increase schooling, because in this model they're deciding whether to go to school, and then after they leave school, whether to work. It decreases teen pregnancy. They find low-skill women are much more responsive to the wage increase. They find black women face a much worse marriage market. And I mean, that totally makes sense because in the US, black men have lower wage offers, you know, so they're, and so, and they also have a greater preference for children. You know, so they find that if you would equalize marriage opportunities, so if black and white women would have the same marriage options, then that would reduce the welfare participation gap. You know, so because the earnings offers are lower for black men, therefore the black women don't get married as often to them, so they have more of an incentive to stay on welfare and have children without being married, partly because of the men earning less money. You know, and so, I mean, everybody kind of thought there were these forces, but this paper tries to quantify, like, how important these things are. And also, they don't find stigma effects. You know, So it's thought that sometimes people don't go on welfare because of the stigma, that they just feel bad about it or something, and they're not finding stigma to be very important. And then within this model, what you can do is you can completely take away the welfare system. You know, so this is like a totally radical thing, totally outside of the data. You can say, what would behavior look like if there was no welfare system? You know, and they're finding that it would eliminate the employment gap a lot and increase black marriage rates if I just would take away the welfare system. You know, and then you could also like change the system, change parameters, like, you know, give it to more people, make the income requirements more lenient, you know, and you can simulate what would behavior be in this different environment. So I would say that's the main benefit of these models that you can do. Like we call these types of analyses counterfactual analyses because it's, you know, different than what was observed. So it's like counterfactual is. And so when you do policy experiments of policies that are not in the data, that's like a counterfactual policy experiment. Okay, so even though these models make stronger assumptions, in order to be able to do that, there's no other way that you could really say what would behavior be without the welfare system. Like I can't think of any, you know, because that's not in the data at all. So how else would you answer that question, you know? So male labor supply has been more about continuous choice of work and savings. So the methods are a little bit different because you have to evaluate first order conditions. You can also have a combination of some continuous choices and some discrete. You know, so you basically just have to evaluate at all the possible options, but you have to check boundary conditions. You know, so it's a little more complicated than would only discrete choices. But in this handbook chapter, we do also talk, I didn't bring slides, but we do also talk about like the male labor supply literature. Mike Keene has several papers in that area. Okay, so now let's look at one example of a schooling model. Because schooling is another decision that's pretty dynamic, right? You decide to go to school more because of the future payoff, right? Or grad school, you sacrifice a lot of earnings to be in graduate school, you know, hoping that in the future you'll get some benefits. So it's a very dynamic decision. So this is a pretty well-known paper from the JPE that models schooling, working, and occupational choices all in one model. It starts at age 16, and people are deciding between five different sectors. So there were some earlier models that modeled schooling, like the choice, do you go to college or not? But like Rosen and Willis was a two-period model. And this model now is every year up until age 65. And then what they use the model for is to analyze the effects of like tuition subsidies. So if you make it cheaper to go to college, how many more people would go? You know, and that's still hotly debated in the U.S. You know, like Obama was trying to make community college free, you know, and so I had a student on the job market last year. She had a model of the decision to go to community college, which is like a two-year college, versus a four-year college, you know, versus no college. So if you make tuition free at the two-year colleges, turns out some people switch from four-year to two-year. You know, because now it's free, and so it's an empirical question, you know, and if you want to answer those questions before you do it, you know, you need some sort of framework for doing that. So in their model, these were the choices. You could go to school, work in white collar, blue collar, work in the military, or stay home. And then it was age 16 to A, which is like age 65. And then people, they start off with some initial conditions at age 16, and then they get different shocks over their lifetime. And so because of the endowments and the shocks, then they have different paths. Okay. So the notation is just their M alternatives. DM equals 1 if you choose alternative M. R is the reward from choosing alternative M. The first three are work alternatives, and the reward is assumed to be the wage in the simple model. And then they have a rental price, so it's kind of this human capital pricing equation with some endowment that depends on like years of schooling. Okay, so this is like the wage equation. Then they take logs, you know, so it's basically this. And then they have actual experience accumulating, because the model, they have like sector-specific experience. Because actually in their data, since they, in the NLSY, you see people from when they're young, so you actually know how many years have they been a blue-collar worker. Right? A lot of times you wouldn't see that in your data, but they actually have that. Okay, and then this is number of years of schooling. Okay, so this is the wage equation. It looks like a Minshew equation, but the motivation is actually more the Ben Perath. This is Ben Perath interpretation. Ben Perath, he was a very good economist, but he was killed at a young age in a car accident. So he's got like a few papers that were very influential, and then we lost him. So, but he had a different way of interpreting the wage equation. And they both, Mincer and Ben Perath, it looks the same, but it's a completely different way of motivating. And he had, Ben Perath had a, he had a theoretical dynamic schooling model, actually. Okay, so if you go to school and you're in college, you can put tuition costs. So here you pay this cost if you attend college, and you could have a different tuition if you attend graduate school. And then you can use the model to simulate if you make it free or if you give a subsidy, how does that affect school-going behavior? Okay, and then there's some reward from staying home. And what they do is they assume everything's joint normal. People start at age 16, so that's their initial grade level. This is the state space, is there all their endowments at age 16. So endowments, they have like unobserved types. They actually have multiple versions of the model. So if you look in the paper, it's a really nice paper. So it's a nice, I think if you just wanted to look at one paper, you know, this one's pretty clear. And Mike King gives out the code too that goes with the paper. So you can also see how they programmed it. But they have multiple versions. They have like a basic model, and then they find the basic model doesn't fit everything, and then they augment the basic model some. You know, but they have these five shocks that are multivariate normal, and this is the state space. And this is the unobservable part, the epsilons. Okay, so they're maximizing, the value function is just maximizing the expected present discounted value. They solve it backwards exactly the way I was describing. Experience evolves with the choices, and also grades completed evolves with the every year you go to school. It's assumed that you pass.
Excuse me, is there no opportunity cost in this model? The foregoing wages?
Or no, there is. Yeah, because if you go to school, you can't work.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Because there's no working while in school. So there actually are some models that allow for part-time work while in school. But in this model, if you go to school, you can't work at all. So there's like big opportunity costs, yeah. Okay, and so basically starting age 16, you know, you have your initial conditions, which they have unobserved heterogeneity, that they're different types, and then they have the grade level at age 16, and then you just draw these shocks. And then you just repeat this process. And there's no closed form because of everything being normal and not all additive. So they do numerical solutions. So let's look, since we don't have tons of time, I want to look. This is the data. And so that the likelihood is similar to the way I already showed you, kind of. So it's probability you make a choice given the state space at each age that they observe them. So the model goes to age 65, but they don't see everybody that long. They only see people until their early 30s. You know, and actually now they've been following the NLSY. These people are still followed, I think. So we've seen them, because this paper came out in 97. So we actually have a much longer history on these people. I haven't seen anybody like trying to do something like this, incorporating more data, because now we actually have much more data on these people. And they started also an NLSY. They use the NLSY 79. Did I say 97? Because they also have a 97. They have NLSY 79. They're still following them. And then they also have the NLSY 97 when they started a new group. And they're also following them. So they actually collect more information on 97 than they had in 79. But the people are younger, so there are two NLSY cohorts. Okay, and the estimation is exactly how I described it. So let's just look at some of the results because we don't have tons of time. So empirical results, they use this NLSY 79, 1,373 observations that they see over time. They convert wages to full-time equivalent wages because they're not modeling the hours decision. Okay, they have four unobserved types. The occupations are blue collar, white collar, and military. So this is the type of data they're trying to fit. You know, so at age 16, most people are in school, but then you can see that that goes down. And then some people drop out of school, stay at home. You know, so you can see the percentage at home. White collar is initially pretty low, but then, you know, in the 20s it goes up, and that's probably because, you know, college is required for a bunch of white collar jobs. So after people finish college, then they often get white collar jobs. And then the military is kind of a small proportion here. You know, so these are the patterns that we're trying to fit with the model, these patterns about choices. This is the permanence, the state dependence. This is looking at what's the probability of being in this sector given that you were in this sector. So like given you were white collar before, what's the probability you're in white collar now? Okay, and you can see these numbers are pretty high. This is like the probability of staying in the same sector. And that's what's hard to fit if you don't have any unobserved heterogeneity. It's hard to fit the state dependence. Okay, so that's this column here, or these numbers on the diagonal. And this, I don't know why it got kind of smushed here, but this is just looking at like goodness of fit. Oh no, this is just data. This is just describing the data. For people with a certain grade level, what's the percentage that stay in school? So let's look at, these are wage patterns, you know, and you can see white collar wages. At first, white collar is even lower than blue collar for very young people, you know, but then white collar gets to be a lot, they have a higher wage increase with age. Okay, and military wages are kind of low. Okay, so that's the type of wage data that we'd be trying to fit. And then we want the wage data to rationalize the choices observed in the data as well. So these are they do two different models, like a basic model and then an extended model. You know, so these are like parameters from the basic model, but they actually find the extended model works better. So this is a goodness of fit for the basic model and then the dynamic programming extended model. So they find the basic model. Well, one thing that's kind of major, in the basic model, you only care about wage in the occupational sectors. But in the extended model, they assume that they're also just like what they call psychic costs to choosing certain sectors. Like you enjoy being a white collar worker. That, you know, that would have to be the interpretation. Because otherwise it's difficult to explain based on wage data alone why people are choosing this sector. Like wage data is like a ROI model, if you know the ROI model, where you just choose an occupation based on wage. Like that's a restriction, right? Whereas if you incorporate some sort of just utility from having that occupation, you get to wear nicer clothes to work or something like that, you know, and you enjoy that. So those are called psychic costs. And sometimes you need things like that to fit the data within these models. So, but the extended model has more parameters. And the other thing, it's hard to fit why people leave school at age 18, because it's basically that high school ends at age 16. You know, but that's not in this model, like the institutional feature. How do you incorporate that, that, you know, most people graduate age 18, so at least in the US. And so they have like a graduation effect, that you get utility when you graduate high school at age 18, you know. So you can incorporate these things to try and capture the pattern that school drops off at the year that corresponds to graduation. And then they also do a couple other models, like they do a repeated static model. And this was some sort of non-structural model that they did. You know. So this is percent choosing white collar. For some of the choices, you can see this is like goodness of fit. They're basically looking which model fits the data. Like here, percentage in school. See, the basic model doesn't capture the data very well. The fact that people like, you know, leave school at a certain age. So the extended model does better, basically. So you can look at, you know, these plots. And then these are like formal goodness of fit tests, right? There was a question about how do you know if your model fits well? You can do some formal tests of the model. These are parameters that they got. So you can see like the returns to schooling for like white collar, blue collar. So returns to schooling is 0.07. That's like a 7% return per year of schooling. So schooling has a bigger payoff in the white collar sector than in the blue collar sector. So that makes sense, I think. And then they have type turns out to be very important. That different types of individuals have very different wages. You know, so one of the big findings from this paper is that unobserved type plays a very important role in explaining lifetime inequality. You know, so, and it's kind of interesting because type is determined at age 16. So it's basically saying something that happened to you very early in life that you already have at age 16 is, you know, explaining a lot of your lifetime choices. Okay. Yeah, these were like utility from school and from home. Well, the main thing that they do is they use this model for tuition subsidies. Okay, so, and there's a kind of a debate, I would say, in the US about whether tuition subsidies are an effective policy for, you know, because certain populations have a low rate of college going. Would they go if it were free, you know, or would they go if we gave them $2,000 a year to go? So here you can look for different types in the data. So you can simulate the response to a tuition subsidy for different types of people. So they find that, like, if I give it to type one, like no subsidy with a subsidy. So here, more people graduate college, right? Actually, all the types, college graduation goes up. This is the average schooling level increases somewhat, like for all the types. This is number of years in college. I mean, type one, they all went to college anyways, so you don't see a lot of response for them, because almost everybody was a college graduate anyways, even without the subsidy. You know, so you see more response here. You know, so from this table, you would think, oh, it's kind of effective maybe, right? It looks like everybody's responding, but But you can actually look at the utility, because in a structural model, you actually get estimates of the utility, you know, and if you look at the utility does not go up that much for these other types. You know, so the big beneficiaries of the tuition subsidy in terms of utility turn out to be type one. Okay, so these are people that would have gone to college anyways, and now they get to go for free. You know, so, and these other people, even though they go to college, some of them, you know, they don't get that much of a return from it, like based on the estimates. You know, and that's because they're kind of lower types that, I mean, actually certain types prefer home, certain types prefer blue collar work, you know, but one of the big findings from their study is that type one, the people that would have gone to college anyways, they are the ones that benefit most from the subsidy, you know. So in their paper, they only do $2,000, but they could have actually done a range of tuition subsidies and looked at different. You can also do, there are many different things you could do. You could do like compulsory schooling law. You force everybody to go a certain number of years, or you could do like a high school graduation bonus, you know, where you give people a bonus only if you finish. Because a tuition subsidy is like you get money every year, you know, whereas a bonus would be only if you complete college, then you, you know, get the subsidy. So they don't do that in the paper, but within this framework, you could think about doing those sorts of policies as well. You know, I think different countries have different policies. Like right now, I'm working with Australian data, using kind of a similar type of model, and we're also doing tuition subsidies, and they also had a compulsory schooling law, so we're looking at that as well. And we actually, we introduced personality, like the big five, you know, that they were talking about earlier, into this type of model. So we're looking at how that evolves over time with schooling choices. And all right, so I think we're done, right? 12:30? Any questions or anything? Okay, all right, thank you.